We're moving to the second part of our summit, which is very interesting, especially for the entrepreneurs. It's going to be very delighting. It's going to be a conversation one-on-one with this entrepreneur who we're going to be, you know, Rajesh is going to be welcoming. A lot of lessons to take away. Keep your questions prepared because this is going to be one fun session. All right, so handing over to you, Rajesh.
Well, good evening, friends. After what the beautiful Manisha Natarajan did of moderating the real estate panel, I've been given a difficult charge of moderating the inspiring conversations, but I'll try and do justice to it. Friends, inspiring conversations, today we are on the 34th session, and this is an entrepreneurial journey which becomes learning from the experiences of successful entrepreneurs. The objective is to create content which can be looked upon by budding entrepreneurs and also ongoing entrepreneurs on how they can do their enterprises better from the experiences of successful people. So we are just going to enjoy the next 30 minutes in this interaction, and for which I would like to invite a very renowned personality in Singapore, Mr. R. Dhinakaran. Gentlemen, we have got a very known person amongst us for all the Singaporeans, and we are just going to enjoy the next 30 minutes of interacting with him. The session has got two parts. One session is the interaction with me, and the second part is we are just going to conclude this in 30 minutes, where the audience needs to ask what I must have missed out. So we are now going to interact with Mr. R. Dhinakaran, who is, like I said, a renowned personality in Singapore, including India. He is a Singaporean today, but his origins are from India. The objective is inspiring conversations is done by people who are Indians. Either they are Indians from India or Indians staying abroad, but origin is from India. So Mr. Dhinakaran is with us. We all know that he's from the fashion industry. He's into a lot of retail business. And when he came in, he said a very interesting statement. If you want, I can change my shirt and wear a white shirt. But since I'm from the fashion industry, let me look a little different on stage. So do you want me to change the shirt? I said, no, it's not required. What we want are the success anecdotes that you have achieved in your journey as an entrepreneur. Friends, there are very few people across the world, especially Indians, who have risen from beginning at a different stage and reaching to the heights that Mr. R. Dhinakaran has achieved. He has not only achieved the success in the entrepreneurial journey that he has done, but he's also been a public representative for the people of Singapore when he was a nominated member of parliament in a prominent country like Singapore. When we discuss about business and entrepreneurship, we classify the world into three categories: the developed countries, the developing countries, and the underdeveloped countries. When I'm standing in Singapore, it gives a lot of pride to say that Singapore is one of the best developed countries in the world, where everything is systematic, where any Singaporean, when he commits something, it is considered to be done, where you can rely on the commitments and the words given by the entrepreneurs in this country. So when we discuss entrepreneurship of Singapore, we come back from India, which is a developing country and one of the fastest developing countries in the world. Like to have some knowledge and experiences from him which can be beneficial for us back home in India, for all the budding entrepreneurs that is happening today in India. So Mr. Dhinakaran, welcome to Inspiring Conversations, and we can now begin. So sir, you have been in the retail management, retail business as an entrepreneur, and like a developed country where competition is always going to be fierce, you have been operating in this business for the last 35 years. The learnings would have been plenty. I would like to begin by saying, how do you manage to sustain, survive, grow, and multiply in a highly competitive market like Singapore?
Firstly, I would like to congratulate the organizers, and it's a great event, the sharing. All the eminent the panel members have shared a lot of information for Singaporeans and NRIs who are in Singapore about Indian property sector. And Rajesh, you mentioned that Singapore is one of the developed countries. We didn't just come out just like a developed country. 50 years ago, 1965, we came out of Malaysia, Singapore. We were the third world country. we were one of the third world countries.
So I think this is one of the fastest grown third world country to a first world country. It is fastest.
Yes.
I'm sure it has happened because of people like you as well.
No, but when you are saying that, how you manage that, it is not the entire business community. It is the country has given a great opportunity for every entrepreneur, every businessman, all, not only the local businessman, but a lot of MNCs have invested in Singapore. That is a success. Because in Singapore, we do not have any natural resources whatsoever. Even for water, except the air we breathe in here, everything else is imported. So we don't have anything except our qualified people, less than 5 million people, Singaporeans as on date. With that small country, small number of people living here, and all done because of our leadership. But not only with the leadership, all the population, the people have been trained to do every, as passing the time, I mean, every now and then we develop ourselves, we understand the market, we just keep ourselves updated with the market and we grow. But you ask me, what did I do to learn to keep this long in the retail sector?
How did you handle the competition?
Competition, you know, Singapore is a place, it's a very open economy. Competition is not only the local players. Many countries have got the protectionism policies. But here is open economy. Anybody from anywhere in the world can come and set up a business. So the competition is the most critical, and that is a great training ground for a Singaporean to come out successful in business, because you are meeting international competitors. They are very smart people. Even out there, a lot of Indians who have come from India is extremely brilliant and intelligent people, and they street smart. Even competing with the Singapore Indians with the Indian Indians is not easy, I can tell you that. Leave alone that Indians, but any other continent, even from Europe, America, Australia, anywhere else, all the people have come and settled down in Singapore. They have started so many MNCs, and they are all thrived, they are successful. Over time, the sectors have changed, and the competition is also growing stiffer and stiffer, but we are all coming out of that with pure the technology and the differentiation.
So in India, when we face competition, we try to beat the competition with a better product, lower price, better buying facilities, better campaigns, more advertising, more personal touch. We do all of that to beat the competition. What did you do in your journey as a strategy to beat your competition or be competitive in the market?
But if you talking about retail sector, the retail sector is ever changing because it's a lot of challenges all around. You can see a brand, it's a branded goods is the one I'm focusing on. We have been doing, as a company, we have been doing more than 50 years. Before the independence, our company has started the Levi's distribution. Even today, we are doing it. How is it possible? Many of the brands have come and gone in this world. But why we are able to do? Because of the better quality. Every now and then, the quality has been changing. The fabrics have been changed. The technology, the lot of tech applications have been done in the jeans. Those days, those people who have been wearing jeans, today you can see all the celebrities, you can go see them going for big events and all that, they wear the jeans. Because jeans is the in thing and the culture. And accordingly, they change. They have, the product has been improved and very comfortable. Even today, I was about to wear the jeans, but I thought you may not allow me to come with the jeans. And so it's such a comfortable jeans have come out because of product quality. And the second one is the differentiation. What we do is, everything what we do, we are differentiating ourselves. Because the competition is can copy next day. You can do it, there is a time gap within 2 or 3 years. Before that, next competitor copying it. So you have to all the time think the new innovations and technology and apply them and improve your business.
You're a multi-brand company. So for you, selecting the right brand is very critical. A wrong selection might really boomerang in the market and it might defeat you with your competition. When you select a brand, what are the parameters that you have tick boxed in your mind to select a brand before launching it in Singapore or any other part of the world? How do you select a brand? What are your parameters?
You know, basically it's very...
How do you select a brand and how do you select the product?
You know, generally people think retail industry is nothing very simple. Just pick up a brand and then keep it here and sell it, open a shop and sell it. Easy, you know. But it's not easy. You are right. You have to do very scientifically. You have to apply all kinds of testing and the focus group and analysis and research has to be done. Which are the brands you are doing it? Which are the countries it has been already distributed? How it has been done? Who are all the shoppers? And how it has been doing the other countries, whether it can fit in Singapore or not. And we look at all these things, we do the research, we understand that first. Even sometimes my people go to overseas and stand in front of some of the stores and see what kind of customers are coming there. And Singapore, do we have those kind of customers here? Or they are traveling here? So that is how we used to analyze that. And after that, a lot of discussions and the launch and many more. But not that all the brands we take are successful. After 5 years, after 10 years, there are many brands because of the time lapse and they don't improve the quality, they don't improve with the times and the fashion is changing and many of them really are not successful. But still, we are holding many brands in Singapore successfully.
So Singapore is a level playing field where everybody has got great infrastructure, strong customer base, lot of tourism happening, lot of people come to Singapore for shopping. So retail is a very powerful mode of doing business. But like we say, the ambience can be good, the product can be fantastic, but you also need to have very competent people who can sell the product. You have got more than 1,000 employees who are into the retail space selling the products to the potential customers. A really good salesman can sell even a comb to a bald man. That's what they say in sales. How do you ensure that the workforce that you're having has got the right set of training to perform the desired results?
I thought he was talking about comp and the bald man. I was thinking he's hitting me so hard. I don't have any comp, I think. Yeah. My hand is good enough to adjust my hairs flying off. Thanks for the question. You know, we have been doing business in many countries, including India those days, and even Europe. And currently, we have been doing business even in Dubai. Currently, we are doing in Malaysia, Indonesia, Singapore, and Thailand. All the countries may look very homogeneous, but it is not. Each country, the people's talent is different. So accordingly, we need to train them. We have to guide them. And you know, the philosophy, our company, if you see that almost 30% of our space in the office space is used for training rooms. And there are many trainers around. They teach A to Z, meaning the product training, the knowledge of the product, how to sell, sales skills, and many more. And after retaining a lot of people's training, and the people leave this company because here, very hot market. In Singapore, we don't have enough manpower to come forward to sell in the front line, sell our goods. Very, very challenging. Because government also having a very tight labor policies and we can't import foreign talent for salesmanship and many other things. Therefore, we have to make use of everything and main thing now more of technology. What we have done is we have started many years, those days we put more people, we just start selling and training them, that's enough. But today, the omni-channel is the key here. So what we are doing is our people have been trained to just tap the tablets and then show to the customers, this is what you're asking, is that like that? Show the real product and also show them a lot more information on that. Some of the customers are keen to read themselves to understand within the store. So we have put in a lot of tablets in the stores and they can learn what good about the products. Not only that, where else it has been sold, where it was manufactured and what are the good aspects of the product, all they will explain. If you go for online, these opportunities, these explanations, you may not be able to get. You can get some of the products, but not for everything what in our store.
What do you do as policies and strategies to make sure that the trained people that you have, which is the core of your business, right, having the right trained manpower, what resources or strategies do you apply to make sure that they are retained with your organization and that they are not jumping into competition, getting trained by you, and operating elsewhere? What are your policies which hold them back with you?
You know, I mean, in Singapore, we train everybody, whether they stay with you, they go to any other company, they go to other multinationals, multinational companies, foreign companies, they can pay even much, much higher pay. because they can take the trained people. We may lose that. But as a government policy, we have got here in Singapore, we focus on the skills future. And basically what we do is from the students until above 60, 65, even 70, we train every Singaporean. And even if you lose, we will lose to another company, another establishment in Singapore. So the aim is that, the country's aim is that, every labor force in Singapore, everybody has to be trained. That is the motto, that is the motive. Billions of dollars have been invested. I'm also involved in that, and I'm working very hard to train the whole of Singaporeans about the future. They call it a skills future. Everybody getting even $500 free by the government, anybody, any course they like. We have got 25,000 courses, approved courses, just for 2 days, 1 day, 5 days, they can attend, they can enrich themselves. It can be a hobby, it can be anything, or it's a part-time job.
Any one good policy that you make sure that it helps you to control your attrition rate? Because movement of manpower from one organization to the other impacts your, not only the top line, but also the bottom line. Because the gestation period of getting another person coming into the place who has left does impact on the revenue flow. So what is that one policy which might ensure that the attrition rate is under control?
If I have to claim that, we have got a wonderful policy in our company that the profit share portion for the employees, we are very transparent in the system. And every year, end of the year, we brief the entire company staff, all the countries separately, how was their performance? How did we perform the last year? And what are the pitfalls, whether bad or good, all that. And also very transparent system of profit sharing for the employees. And I would like to tell you that our people, we have got people in the company, more than 40, 45 years old people, many of them still working in the group. That shows that we are very genuine, because we don't think that there is a boss and subordinate relationship. We tell them, all the staff, that you make the company. People, you make the company. You are the team members. You are the part of the family, part of the family of the company. That's how we deal with every individual.
Fantastic, fantastic. So you have ensured that the people working in your organizations are partners in profits. And that helps you to retain them in your organization. And that's how your organization has sustained, survived, and grown. Mr. Dhinakaran, what basically your company has done is you have gone into geographical expansion. You're into Singapore, you're in Jakarta, you're in KL, you're in India, you're in Dubai. Now, these are all variety of locations geographically. Every country has got its own set of cultures, policies, challenges. So how do you balance your business expansion strategies depending on the country where you're operating from?
It's a very good question, because many of us think that, you know, especially retail is very easy. Some of them just now mentioned location, he was mentioning. But if you think retail in Singapore is the same like retail in India or retail in Middle Eastern country or in Jakarta, yes, I agree with you, lot of difference, because many of us don't understand the cultural differences. Whenever you go to any foreign country, even Malaysia, if you go there, you have to understand the culture first. You know, in our business school in Singapore, MBAs, we have got the first importance for the MBA students is the cross-cultural management is the key paper, because there are many papers in that. Because we have to understand the culture of all the neighboring countries, at the same time, the Westerners, the Japanese, the Indians, and all of everything has got a lot of variances. You can see that. I see that myself, how different it is. But everywhere we have to adopt the changes, and we should respect the people where you are there to do a business. And therefore, we understood that, and we have got local managers to help. The country managers are there to support, recruit people, but you may go and select key people, but other people, somebody else locally, bring them and train them. They also give a lot of constant feedback if you do whether increment or bonus or training or any whatever. Even for their family wedding, you have to do something, we will do. If there is a childbirth in one of the employee's house or employee has got a new child born, what we have to do, everything we learn and we adopt those practices, the best practices, in order to retain and manage the business. Without the staff, we can't do it. But at the same time, the advertising culture, you know, in retail so-called, we call it as an omni-channel. We have to be, those days, everybody come to your shop, but no more they come to the boutique, that's it. You know, not like that. People can sit at home comfortably, can buy any goods from anywhere. You all know that the challenges. But every country, you have to really suit their needs, and we have to adopt the omni-channel presence.
During your process of expansion into multiple cities across countries, what was the homework that you did before you launched a new country? What was the gestation period and how many months it takes for a retail organization to expand into a new country depending on geographical distance, depending on investments, depending on opportunity calculation? What is your gestation period and how do you do your homework for getting into a new country?
It is totally different today from 10 years, 20 years, 30 years back. Those days we had to go by, you know, whom you know in that country, you go and meet them, some businessmen, and understand the facts. Today, nobody's, lack of any information. Just, you know, touch a button, you know the demographic, what kind of goods being sold, what is the people purchases, what is the many, lot of data you can get it. In addition to that, the consultants are there to help you also some extent. But we hear from them, it takes, you know, 3 to 6 months before you decide whether you can start the business. But after the decision, this retail business is not so easy. You can just start because you need to get a proper location. The location is a key anyway, but that is your showroom. And people think, oh, this brand is there because you have to be in the right place in the beginning. If you are starting somewhere wrong footing, then the brand will be completely gone. So we will get all these details and then we move forward. By the time we start operating, minimum 1 to 2 years it may take, but after that, growing the business takes many more years.
As a business owner, business can grow only when you delegate authority with responsibility. When you share responsibility, you also need to give authority to the subordinates. After giving authority and responsibility, what is your mechanism of monitoring whether that authority is rightly used or misused?
It's a great question because many people think give a lot of responsibility to people. All the managers are given lots and lots of responsibility. If anything goes wrong, call so-and-so, XYZ. Come on, come explain to me why this has happened. But if we don't give, the authority and responsibility should go together, hand in hand. It should be in the same level. One cannot be higher than the other. In the sense that if you give a junior person high authority, wrong authorities, they may misuse it. But at the same time, the managers, you have to give them. Say, for example, I give you one simple thing. We give authority to our retail store manager. If any country, anywhere, if they go, if the customer buys something, if they have to return, immediately they see it, the customer wanted to return, the manager has got authority to return and give them credit note or sell any other goods or any other brands within the group. Anything is possible. If they want cash, within few days, it will be refunded. This kind of empowerment, this kind of authority has been given to the store manager, but not to every salesman.
How do you monitor the use of that authority? Is there any mechanism in place?
Yes.
Or is it by chance it happens that you get it monitored?
MIS is a management reporting. You know, again, the retail is detail. The devil is in the details. So we get the reports, systematic reports. Those days are manual reports. But now, fortunately, because of the technological help, we get every day, even the sales numbers must have already come to my pocket, you know. Few countries, they just send hourly information, some reports. I may not see everything, but somebody else will be seeing it who is interested to see it. Who has to see it, he will see it. So purely the reporting and monitoring system will explain to us, and we have got a company kind of SOP. We give them the SOP, meaning standard operating procedures. And it has got complete manual, which will tell you, even the new people can understand our system, how it works. Therefore, the day they started, within a week, they will be operational. They can understand all the rules and regulations of the company and the reporting system.
One last question before I open the house to the audience to ask questions. How would you challenge the challenge of online shopping? Organizations like Amazon, Alibaba, and loads of other online portals which have come up across the world, including Singapore. How do you challenge that challenge?
This is the most difficult question I ever thought, but this is the right question you asked, because many people telling me Amazon has come to Singapore, Alibaba is so aggressive, Celora is big in Singapore. Celora is an international company set up here in Singapore, big way. And Lazada is here online. And so many online portals are available in Singapore. And our country is so small, and 5 million people here, and 15 million people in every year coming to Singapore. And how we manage? The challenge, yes, it is there. The past 2012 to 2016, almost 4 or 5 years, we were facing this kind of challenge, because all the youngsters, many of them like to buy online. I can tell you that. They come to my stores. If they look at the shoe, this nice shoe, they go to the store, they just see the shoe and take the code numbers. And the lady shoe, we used to sell something like 1,000 to 3,000 Singapore dollars per pair. Even the Thai Thais, we call it the rich women, they go to the store, they take that photo of, today all the technology smartphone, just take the click and get the number, get the shape, the color, everything. They go online, they get it 10% or 15% or 20% cheaper somewhere else. They will get it. They will shop around because they get $300 to $500 savings. Why not? It's a fantastic. So that kind of challenges are existing. So some of the brands we have closed, victims of the online. I agree with you. Because Singapore is, has got some limitations. We don't have a right to sell certain brands in other countries or in Europe or Western world. It's not allowed. We have got a right restricted in this region. We can't go beyond that. Therefore, they can, Singaporeans can go to a European website and buy from the factory or somewhere else. So online. That is, makes it so easier for them to do it. But at the same time, ladies here can tell me, it's not easy to buy the clothes on online without trying that. Unless you try the clothes, if you buy it, what you see in the screen, you know, beautiful, colorful, nice like that, when you see the TV or the computer screen, but in real fact, after getting it back, it is not the same color. When you think this is the right size for you, but it may not fit you well, it looks very shabby. Therefore, like especially our jeans and all, it's very difficult to buy without trying that. So especially for ladies and even men today, without trying, they will not buy the jeans. Even the same brand jeans, if they are buying, because the models are different, the season is different, there may be slight tweaking into the sizes and the correct places, you know, what to show, what not to show, to our body, we have to control all that. So therefore, online is giving greatest challenge, but at the same time, offline, that is the brick and mortar store, many people telling brick and mortar store is completely gone. Because of the technology, a lot of intermediaries have been eliminated. We all know Uber, we know it very well, right? This online e-commerce, many, many industries have been changed because of that. But one thing I can tell you, online to offline, offline to online, seamless moving of these two sides is the only way going forward. Even if I got a brick and mortar store, I should be having a presence in online. And because they can see that, they can go to my stores. They can click, they can buy something, they can go to the store to collect it at that time. They can say, let me try that. They can try that first before they collect it. They can say that, no, I ordered this. I want to change something else. Wrongly, I ordered. The color, I thought something else, but this is different. So this is the most important and critical part of success. The critical success factor would be in future, every retailer should have both brick and mortar, that is offline and online. That's the most critical in order for them to survive and succeed.
So which means you need to say that experiential selling will ensure that the offline store will always be permanently there. Just like when people were fearful that online content and online movies and piracy will kill the business of the theaters. But what theaters basically did was, theaters moved out from the revenue that they generated out of ticket sales, and they built the other revenue models because of the theater footfall, and they started making money in the catering that they did at the theaters. So similarly, I think offline and online marriage should happen, but I feel there must be something more that will be needed to make sure that people come for the experiences at the offline stores. Do you think the same?
Exactly. See, we have to, from as the time changes, whatever challenges are coming because of various competition, unexpected, out of the industry. You know, this big online business is purely technological challenge, technological disruption for us. But we have to adopt that, and we should excel in it. That is how we have been. I mean, I have been in the retail business long, and I'm also chairing the Singapore Retailers Association. I tell everybody, many of them telling me, you know, you should lobby this to the government, you have to tell them this, tell them that, can you please tell them this? But we have to change ourselves. We have to learn to adopt the new changes and to face the challenges and excel in it.
Fantastic. The house is open for questions. If you can just take, we'll take five questions. People are hungry. Yeah, Nagu.
That was fantastic. It was like watching a table tennis match. You were throwing questions and you were really getting back after it. Fantastic. Quick question on the same last point. You're saying that online, offline, there needs to be a seamless movement. But we all know that the onslaught of online is pretty heavy and high. Now, I'm not a retailer, so I'm not getting into that. My thing is, what's going to happen to the malls, to the retail spaces? What's the future of what is there currently? Singapore, outside of Singapore, and what do you think is going to be the newer creations? Are there going to be more malls coming in? Are they going to dwindle? What's your take?
Good question, Nagu. You know, in Singapore, Singapore is a very property, if you know that, the property prices have escalated so high over years. And because you all know that we are a very small country, limited scarcity of land, limited land, valuable land. But big companies, real estate companies, the REITs, real estate, you know, the retail investors, the REIT costs a big problem. Big players have invested in the real estate shopping malls. Most of the shopping malls under REITs. And they have invested billions of millions of dollars in all the malls. Now, they are caught by surprise. This online business has also affected them. But some of the malls, learning like retailers, they are also changing their certain levels completely entertainment. Certain levels, originally it was all brick and mortar store. But now they become food courts, restaurants, entertainments, and fitness centers. And there are so many floors because people are working there. After that, they can go and entertain themselves or go to the fitness centers and many things. They are doing that. That is one. But at the same time, there are some malls in Singapore, the key malls. Anybody come from overseas, they will definitely, foreign tourists, foreign people will visit those malls. Be it a Marina Bay Sands or Ion, Orchard Road. They will visit that. Definitely, it is going to be there and it will go on. And another thing, in Singapore, there is a satellite mall or heartland mall or something like that, we call it. Meaning, I don't want to call it a suburban, but, you know, you can call it an Indian.
Distant location.
Yeah, outside this main CBD area. Yeah, outskirts. And there are other cities there, small towns, in other words. And those areas also, there are malls, new malls have come in. And most of them come at the, especially the MRT, that is a train stations, the mall strategically located. Everybody going home time or coming back, they can pick up something and they can go home. Near their house, they don't have to travel extra for shopping. And those kind of malls remain to stay. Unless there are many more supply coming, there may be difficult. They have to live on. Orchard Road, Marina Bay Sands, all these malls, some of the malls will definitely stay forever. But there are some malls, you know, they don't have the clout. They don't have the crowd. They don't have something pulling, crowd-pulling reasons. And those are the malls, they have to change themselves. They have to find a way, new niche. new requirement, how to transform these malls for a different purpose, and that is a great challenge for them, which is going to come very soon within a couple of years' time.
Next question, please. Yes.
As a company, I think he is very humble. The success is not taken to his head. So that's very, very important. And also how, you know, foresee the trend and then keep differentiating and changing. Because he never, I mean, his business side or in his individual side, he never caught by surprises and then react. He was always proactive, right? So something on a personal side, because you talked enough about the company, Dina, I mean, you've been in multiple boards and gone up to the, you know, parliament. But still, even today, even a hawker whom you meet him, he will be so humble as if he has met him 20, 30 years back, right? So let me hear that story for the benefit of everybody, Dina. Thank you.
Has your education got to do with that? Because he's a chartered accountant, he's an MBA. So being proactive and looking into the future, that's what good quality education gives you. Was that one of the reasons?
If you have to be in business, all the entrepreneurs have to have two good important qualities. You have to have faith in you, and in other words, confidence in you, firstly. And secondly, you should take risk. See, some people thinking that, you know everything. I may not know it, but I smell rat, something is coming. So immediately I call my top people and I share with them, this is what I think, we have to do something to counter that. What is coming in, please understand that. You know, exactly, I was telling you a shoes business, and I told somebody that one of our directors said that this shoe is beautiful, excellent, and it will sell like a hot cake, you know, $3,000 per pair for a lady, shoes in Singapore. And I told them, in a couple of years, we may have to shut it down. True, I had to shut it down, that brand. The reason is, I know this online business, I know how it has been sold somewhere else. And I know this is coming very fast, and really that has happened. Similarly, I always looking for future, how to grow this kind of challenging opportunity. I got a health supplement retailing. What I have done it, I got so many stores. I got 30 stores I opened in Singapore. Singapore is a small city state, and how can I open 30 stores in Singapore? And we were cannibalizing our own sales. People everywhere, they can see my store, but that is not the objective, it is not profitable. So what I did, I reduced the size to 16. And I opened the online just a couple of years back. And that compensates better, I make better money. So what I'm trying to tell you is that I foresee this is what will happen, we have to change. And many of my people were not happy to change. Even the managers were very resistant. He says, 30 stores we have, why you want to close it? Loss doesn't matter, some other stores we can close, but other stores we keep, let us not get into online. But we have got into online, it is fantastic. We are very, very happy about it.
Fantastic. Next question, please. Yes.
Dina, you made a very right judgment saying that most of the retail business, of course, they have to go bricks, mortar plus online. It has to go hand in hand, otherwise survival is certainly questionable. My question is, while you are going to get parallel in both online as well as bricks mortar business, of course it will be there. Have you experienced the profit margin shrinking? And I believe certainly so. Then how do you manage to adjust to recover the profitability of the company at the same level?
Thank you, Jaiswal. But you know, it is a challenge, constant challenge. You have to really, if you have to survive long-term sustainability, you have to look at it. If I close the stores completely, people will totally forgotten about me. I keep in online, nobody know what it is. So I have to make it, as I said earlier, seamless connection so that they go to the store, they can know there is online also. They can buy from that if they can't come here. Many of Singaporeans, all the ladies, all the men working in somewhere, daytime. They can't get the parcels at home during the daytime. So when they go back, on the way back home, they can pick up the parcel, that is click and collect. They can click at home 2 days ago or 1 day earlier, and they can say, I can collect from this particular shop, they can collect it.
that the profit margins definitely will get eroded. Yes, I agree with you. But you have to look at the long-term sustainability. If you don't have the brick and mortar, the show, physically somebody has to see the product. You have to feel it. The life experience is also, some of the people are, shopping is a habit. They wanted to go and feel and touch and, you know, enjoy that. And somebody has to say, hello, sir, or hello, ma'am, you know. They feel nice, and therefore, there are many elements to that, consumer service or customer service. So therefore, that part, we need to continue all along. We cannot reduce, but we have to strike a balance at appropriate time, appropriate manner.
Yes.
Just to add in, actually, my question was, Dina, certainly what you said, it has to go parallel. The bricks mortar also be there. But my question was, do you have some mechanics to maintain that profitability level or improve, I mean, maintain when due to online, the profitability has eroded? Is there a mechanism you have found to maintain it in a higher level?
You know, I cannot have the equilibrium very perfectly because it is not, it's a kind of an art. You know, it is not like a science correctly. You can plan correctly. You have to go tag along and look at it this year like that, next year like that. Every month you have to monitor the situation and change accordingly. One more thing, even the brand owners elsewhere in Europe, America, elsewhere, and they also guide us from their experience. So we learn from them, learn from each other, each other's market, and then move forward. It is not a fine number. I can today tell you what is going to be in another 10 years later or 3 years later. Very tough for me.
Thank you.
Yes, Vikas.
So, Dina sir, you know, as an entrepreneur grows or tries to scale up, one of you know, their biggest challenge is to build a second line of management, right? And so my question is that just like an entrepreneur has just that, you know, sort of innate ability to take risk, you know, you said you smell the rat. Do you think that the knack of identifying talent is something that is innate or is something that can be developed by following a certain process?
It is very difficult, you know, you have to really get the right people. But right people will not be right by 100%. They will be right, if they are right by 60%, for me, I'm very, very happy. That can be, I mean, those kind of people can be groomed to 90 and 100, no problem. But you said it in a different way. I thought you were going to ask me about succession plan. Is very, very important, next line of management, and I'm also aging, and I need next young people, the young wave has to come in. Maybe very, very true, that is the correct thing, and I'm going forward to have all my team or very, very young team in place. That is why many people always tell me, you look young. It's true, I'm not young, I look only young. Because just to match them, be with them, joke with them, and mingle with them. So you have to develop the younger generation to come and take over and move forward. Even my son is coming to the business, though he's from a biomedical engineer, all these things, but he has come back to business to help. Yes.
One last question, please. Yes.
What is your take on virtual reality? Will that probably, like, you know, come closer to a real life experience? Not right now, but, like, you know, probably in the next future, yeah.
I mean, I cannot rule that out totally because artificial intelligence 5 years ago, 3 years ago, it was not kind of a great technology. People are going to use it. But today, what I see that it is going to change the game. It is the AI, they call it. And similarly, the virtual reality, also the same. I cannot just say that it is... because I may not understand 100% the way in which it is going to influence the businesses here in Singapore, but elsewhere also, but it can change. Because every day there will be a lot of new things. Those days the business is really different. Today the business is more of a technology and the logistics. The retail I'm talking about is not really retail business. It is more of a technology and it is more of a logistic business. That's why Amazon is so successful. Purely they perfected the logistic business. That's it.
Fantastic. So I think that was a very interesting session. Thanks a ton, Mr. Dina. And I would now like to request Amit Wadhwani and Nagu Chidambaram with Sudha to come and felicitate our chief guest for the inspiring conversations today. That was brilliant, and thanks a ton. Thank you, Mr. Dina. It was a pleasure having you over.